Great. So good afternoon, everybody. Without much, we've actually delayed the session quite a bit. So I hope all of you will enjoy the session and also take a keen interest, because this is one session that perhaps integrates the biophysical basis of our lives here on this planet and the economy much more than perhaps any other session will. The session is about water and justice, and we have two eminent speakers here who've had a lot of experience, but also a lot of fundamental questions that challenge the ways in which we do ecological economics. May I introduce to you Dr. Peter May. He's a scientist, a senior scientist with Biohabitats Incorporated and the University of Maryland. Please give him a big hand. Let's welcome him. And I'd like to introduce Mokgadi Monamati, senior resource specialist from Botswana, who works on natural resources and conservation, and specifically on water questions and access to water. She's here with us today too. Welcome her, please. So we've kind of decided that we'll basically ask both of them to speak about how they see this evolution of the evolution of this question about water and justice, and what is the relationship to the kind of work that they're doing now, and how they came to this question of dealing with water scapes. I mean, we as, well, the human bodies are just one minute part of a much larger waterscape, and we seem to be deciding all the questions of, well, conflicts or justice about water or related to water. I'll stop here now and give Peter the, or which one of you would like to start? Okay.
Dumela. That's a Botswana greeting. It means we're still together. Good afternoon, everyone. We're going to be getting into the issues of water and justice. And as we know, water is a sort of a determining factor in settlements. You know that a settlement cannot mushroom or take off without water. For specifically for Botswana, if I take the example of the Bushmen, they have to identify a source of water before they could settle. And also that when you settle and you see water, then they knew that there's animals, so there's food. So water is essential for life. In the African context, the management of water was going historically back, managed by chiefs. And they made sure that they will store water, and that water is stored specifically for the elderly, for the sick, and for those that are less fortunate in life. For the Bushmen, they'll store water. They store it in ostrich shells, and they know where they've put it, so that in time when there's drought, they know where to go and fetch that water. So that is very important, because you may think that they were not paying for water because it was free. But if you think about it, there were norms that they had to live up to, and that was the price. Because if you go against the norm, then the water may be polluted and the whole tribe is going to perish. And you can imagine in a tribe how you will be treated in that situation. So I wanted us to think back as economists and think about the issue of pricing in water, because this is eventually going to get there, because when you have sufficient water in rivers or in ponds or in lakes, you think that it's free, but as economists we know that it's not free, because you have to travel to get it, you have to live up to some norms to be able to continue being able to live with that water. So it's not free. That is the first very important point that you need to keep in mind, that in those societies, water was not free. But as societies evolved, water had to be stored in dams. We know we have to build pipelines that were crossing neighborhoods and farms. And in that context, you have to understand that you're taking people's land, their grazing land. You're also taking, you may pollute the water as you go. And in the process of putting it in dams, you are making water a commodity. Now we come into the issue of pricing. So people have to pay it, not according to the norms that you are living up to, but now you're paying it in dollars and pula and other currencies. And that is where the issue of social justice comes in, because now the poor cannot afford it. But imagine you've taken it away from them. If you go to Addis, I was in Addis in February, women are walking distances, 6 hours, just to be able to get 5 liters of water. If most of us, I mean all of us here this morning, you wake up in the morning, you just take a shower. You don't even think about where this water is coming from. But just think about it. Somebody has to walk 6 hours or even more. Kids are losing school time, still going to just to get water. Can you imagine the 6 hours that they're losing in school? They're losing their life, because it means they're going to not make it in school because they're spending all their time fetching water. So in a nutshell, I just wanted to give a brief about, you know, especially in the African context and even in traditional ethnic groups, how water is such an important determining factor in settlements. Thank you.
That was excellent. coming from a different perspective, I'm local to here at University of Maryland, and I work at an ecological engineering firm in Baltimore, where we deal with water issues from the perspective of restoration of ecosystems, streams and wetlands and forests, and managing stormwater. And in Chesapeake Bay here, management of stormwater is a very important aspect of what we do from the private sector side, but also from in the academic side. We study it and how best to do it. But there's also the question of payment. And I come from a background. I was fortunate enough to take several classes with Herman Daly, who many of you probably know. And he infused me with a perspective of ecological economics. But also, I come from the Howard Odum School of Environmental Accounting and understanding the energy basis for resource use and depletion. And in Chesapeake Bay, the question is, how do we manage the 64,000 square mile watershed to support the Chesapeake Bay with all of its agriculture and its urban areas and sewage and stormwater? And what we do is we actually, I guess, should I go into it? Oh, okay. Well, so we we were asked to kind of put a few slides together, and I have more than a few. From the perspective of my work in ecological engineering, we come up with novel solutions, usually natural systems, to solve these problems. So we, and I love your perspective of tribal communities and how what we've done in Chesapeake Bay is now each municipality is essentially a tribal community that has to figure out how it's going to solve its nutrient and sediment loads that impact Chesapeake Bay. And so as an ecological engineer, I come to it with an interesting perspective in that we're using natural systems in order to solve these problems. This is an algal turf scrubber, which is an ecologically engineered system using algae. I studied under the great Walter Eady at the Smithsonian Institution in Marine Systems Lab, and he came up with this essentially a biomimetic approach to using algae to clean water. And we've studied it extensively and used it in very large and small scales and to solve this problem of how to clean scrub nutrients out of estuaries, lakes, rivers, streams, using the incredible power of this algae to pull the nutrients out, provide oxygen to the system, and harvesting that algae effectively removes it. So this is an ecologically engineered system that H.T. Odum called ecological jiu-jitsu, which I thought was very interesting because it's using the power of nature to the benefit of society and nature. And And we're doing this for large scale systems like the Port of Baltimore, 1,200 acres of impervious surface area. And where should I be pointing this? There we go. We've done it at medium scales and at very large scales. Hectare, multiple hectare scale systems. But is this environmental justice? I mean, is this, we're cleaning water and we're doing justice to the resource in terms of Chesapeake Bay, but are we doing this, and that's important. When Obama first came into office, he issued an executive order on Chesapeake Bay, and one of the treatment systems that were identified was this algal turf scrubber system, which we've studied around Chesapeake Bay. So as a scientist, this is very interesting to me as an ecological engineer. And to me, this is doing justice by the resource, by Chesapeake Bay. But when we think of water and justice, of course, we've turned it into biofuel, omega-3s, a compost, organic fertilizer, livestock feed. So we found different uses for that algae that we harvest. Is that really justice? Okay, I would say yes, it's justice to the resource, but when we think of justice and water, we think of access to water and clean water, access to natural systems that aren't degraded. Is that justice? I work with students at University of Maryland, and we have several groups of students that a year do these capstone studies for a year. They came up with green bulkhead wetland wall designs in Baltimore Harbor for essentially covering the walls of these bulkheads with these wetland walls, which was very unique, and they put a lot of effort into it. It's fun to work with the students. I almost need to just tell somebody to change the slide. There we go. Another set of students, we entered an EPA Rainworks competition. It was a nationwide competition for managing stormwater on campuses. And this system that they came up with actually was for on campus, a large treatment wet meadow system. And very proud of our students. They won first place out of, I think there were 72 colleges and universities from 23 states, and our team won, and we were very excited about that. Is that justice? Maybe that's justice for managing water on campus, and the students, as a learning exercise, got a lot out of it. Is that water injustice, though? I have students manipulating, in ecological engineering, we're manipulating, creating things like living umbrellas, okay, that they're putting out on campus and creating vines and shaded areas, and that's part of their master's study. Is that justice? Baltimore Waterfront, the Healthy Harbor Initiative, is trying to clean the water in the inner harbor, which is a big attractant for a lot of visitors, and there's essentially, a very large watershed comes down to a very small point in Baltimore Harbor right here, and you know that's essentially the end point of the water that comes through the system. And we all know what happens when you throw things on the street and you get bottles and floatables. You've also facilitated with all the nutrients fish kills in the harbor. So there's, you know, there are other species involved. This ends up becoming a nuisance. It smells very bad. It looks bad. So how to manage it? Especially with so many people, this is a tourist destination. So is managing this water so that we don't have dead fish and bottles in the harbor so the tourists don't see them, is that justice? Here's the National Aquarium in Baltimore. And actually, this is the Baltimore World Trade Center here. This is a blast zone where boats can't come in. It's a negative space. What do we do with that? Uh, You know, people can Photoshop things in and make something that looks good. Is putting a wetland in there, is that justice for the harbor? It's ecological engineering. It's interesting. Is justice coming up with an alternative model for creating these floating wetlands instead of having, you know, an off-the-shelf, a vendor that has them? Do we create our own design that anybody can make and make it an open source, a la Ben Franklin? You know, we want other people to be able to do these. So do we create an alternative design that uses the floating bottles that come into the harbor as the flotation device for these floating wetlands? And do we create interpretive signs and educational aspects that tell students how these things operate, how they benefit the aquatic life, what kind of plants live there? Do we get students to help put them together and teach them how to build these things and use a piece of an education and an aspect of this to build the system? Is that justice? Do we build many of them? Do we have people involved from the community to tow them into and put them in place? It becomes an aesthetic in the harbor with all these tourists and a very wealthy part of the harbor that it draws millions of people each year. That looks very nice. It draws, you know, you've got wildlife that are using this. Is this environmental justice? Is this water injustice? It's an interesting question. You know, this is all to benefit the Healthy Harbor Initiative. Everybody wants clean water and a healthier harbor. This happens to be in the end point of a very wealthy area around the harbor, a tourist destination. Is cleaning that up and giving it a report card, is that justice? Switching gears to a school down the street here, some of you may or may not know, Sidwell Friends School. It's a Quaker school that the president and his wife, the Obamas, send their daughters. Sasha and Malia go to school here. This was the first LEED Platinum school in the country, this building for the middle school. We built a wetland wastewater treatment system in front of the school that was part of its LEED accreditation. So essentially the students walk by the system that treats their wastewater. It's a beautiful system. It incorporates stormwater management. Can somebody just click this when I say change slide? Please? Change slides. Oh, it's you. The system's beautiful. This school, you can attend this school on a sliding scale, okay, in terms of pay. It's very expensive to go here, but it actually has probably one of the most diverse student bodies that I've seen of a K through 12 school, but it is a very expensive system, or school to go to. The decision point to build these systems, the photovoltaics, the passive solar, the reclaimed wood, the stormwater management, all of this. If you were walking through this every day, this would be a beautiful place to go walking through, right? To come to school. The interpretive signage, the forms for the stormwater, the plantings. Next, yes, it's all very beautiful. Next. I manage this system. I have students, actually, that come and take water quality samples from the system in order to understand it better. Next. And they built the system in order to save water. The water from that system is treated and goes into the toilets as reuse water. So they're saving water and they're tracking how much water they're saving. In this area of the country, water is very cheap relatively still. But It doesn't pay for itself. This system is too expensive. Just from water savings, it won't pay for itself. But the board of the school decided that they wanted to build it anyway because it would be an educational aspect for the students who learn about it in environmental science. They learn about it, they do art projects with it in terms of interpretive signage. They understand what ecological engineering is and what happens to their poo. If you have middle schoolers and you talk to them about poo, they get very excited and they're very interested and engaged for some reason. But that's a good thing, right? Is this environmental, is this justice, is this water and justice? It's maybe getting there a little bit with education. But again, this is a very wealthy school. If every school was like this in the country, that would be wonderful. That would be justice, to my mind, okay? If you had this level of education, it's important to have these as examples. But you know, we need to get there to all the schools, maybe not with a wastewater treatment system, but these kinds of things for learning, the stimulation. All the students that are coming out of this school are gonna do great things because they have teachers and a model and a really beautiful place to go to school. Next. But this is an American Institute of Architects project in Baltimore that a competition that I had some students work on. They looked at a 3 square blocks in Baltimore City. There were only 3 out of 85 homes that were lived in. The entire rest of the blocks were abandoned. They wanted us to look at it in terms of how it could be transformed into a resilient row house community. All of the design teams they put together, they put photovoltaics, they were growing food, they had stormwater management, all of the water and wastewater was being reused. 50% of all of the water, all of the water that fell on the site was used on site. All of these things were great, but what's missing from it, and I think one of the great things that our guest last night that gave the talk, she spoke about cooperatives and how more people are involved with cooperatives in the world than our shareholders and all the publicly traded companies. We decided to build this system as a cooperative system from the top down so that people that were living there affordably would also have a say in their governance. They would have jobs maintaining the system. So social equity, environment, economics, we all understand they're all mixed together. So when we're doing these projects, these interesting ecological engineering projects that solve a problem for a municipality so that it meets its EPA goals, or we're designing beautiful floating wetlands that are out in touristic areas that are great and it has an educational component, I think that's very important for students. But when we're really talking about solving our problems in terms of water and justice and equity, we really need to be talking about where people live, large groups of people, and how they can live well and also live with a say in their governance and how they do it. And so we built a cooperative model into our system, and that actually, because all the rest of the designs were essentially the same, but ours had that cooperative governance model that really actually put us over there. We won that competition, which was really interesting, and we hope to implement it in Baltimore City, which needs a lot of help. Next. This goes back to the wetland wastewater treatment system at Sidwell Friends. And I end with this slide because if you have an engineered wastewater treatment system that spontaneously causes students to create a modern dance routine about wastewater, then you've really done something, okay? And to me, that is justice, but justice is not just having the kind of inspiration with ecological engineering and systems where students learn at a very wealthy school, but if we can have that kind of inspiration for schools all over, then that to me is, and understanding how water works and furthering their education, that's truly justice.
Thank you, Peter, that was wonderful. I just have one, I mean, since you kept repeating, is that justice? I mean, the key question about justice, I mean, if you look at the EJ Atlas that Jean Martinez-Elia and friends have put up, you see that about 70% of all conflicts, about environmental conflicts, are about water or related to water. So contexts where water is scarce and water is plenty, contexts where there is rich and poor, there's those kinds of divides, tourists versus where people live and use water. There is a concern about what kind of, well, let's say, definition of justice do we have? What is our conceptualization of fairness? Is it, I mean, like in the morning session where Renato Maloof was talking about justice as equal, everybody is equal. So is that the conceptualization of justice? I mean, everybody has an equal access or right to water. Everybody has a say in the governance of water. I'd just like both of you to reflect on that, maybe about 5 minutes each. Yes. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Yes, I'm just reflecting back to what I said earlier on the poor not being able to afford. For me, justice is when there's a phrase that says people think that the opposite of poverty is wealth. But the opposite of poverty is actually justice, social justice. Because if we all know that we need to be kind to each other, we need to do the right thing to each other, then we won't have mining companies and big companies coming into a village to drill water for cleaning up diamonds or coal at the expense of the community. For me, that's the beginning of justice, when we understand that my welfare is also your welfare. And when you are disimpoverished, I am disimpoverished. And for me, when I look at issues of water and justice, and how governments, because we know we have signed up to the Millennium Development Goals, I mean, we now on the Sustainable Development Goals, and we are setting up to say we want to everybody to have access to drinking water. But governments are struggling to achieve that. And then you ask yourself, but why? And you find that in many cases it's because the big companies are given more, are more favored, or they're more power because they have money. So for me, when we're talking about water and social justice, and when I take back to the work that we do in Botswana on water accounting, is to say, how can we still achieve the GDP that we want by not disimpoverishing the poor? And I take an example of a water accounting project that we did, that we realized that the Debswana, DBS, it's a mining company in Botswana, and they were taking so much water that farmers had to be, they had to abandon their farms because they couldn't drill further. They couldn't drill, let's say they had a borehole that was 100 meters deep. And when Debswana came in to take so much water, it means that now they have to drill 300 meters and they can't afford it. So they had to abandon their livelihoods. So the issue is that you balance. Yes, I didn't know it's up there. Okay, but this is the water accounting that we did, and this was my presentation that I made to the African Union, still trying to promote this idea that as Africa we are so rich and yet so poor. And when I was looking at that, it was the I wanted to talk about this later. Let me finish with the question. Because the idea is that when we went and did the Debswana study, they realized that they were having so much waste, and they didn't know it before we did the study, the water accounting study. So they started to work on recycling. So that assisted the aquifers to accumulate. And the municipal that the company that is supplying water to the town realized that they were also losing about 40% in terms of in the production line, or whether it was pipes leaking or bad infrastructure. And when they fixed that 40%, it means that they didn't have to increase prices. For me, that's justice, because people are paying they're not paying for waste, they're paying for what they're using. I'm not too sure, I think we need to finish this, then I can do my presentation, thank you.
Right. So many of the projects that I related that I'm involved in the applied world and am mixing with the academic world and my students and research, and they all benefit somebody: the Baltimore Waterfront Corporation, the Port of Baltimore, Sidwell Friends School, municipalities that have a need to meet their water nutrient and sediment load reduction goals. These are all entities at different scales, but what does it mean in terms of justice? They're meeting their needs in terms of regulatory requirements or some kind of educational tool or an aesthetic in wealthy touristic areas. But to me, justice does mean access to clean water, but in terms of potable water, but also affordability relative to what you were saying in terms of mining companies get a pass. I mean, they can afford these costs, and when you have, here water is relatively cheap, but it's going up. They're imposing stormwater fees, and when you're the cost of living, and your water bill. I know my water bill is, and I live very small in a very small place. It's a cost, and when you don't make enough money and you're looking to pay bills, that's difficult. So I think relative pricing is important, but I think that to my mind, using water as an educational tool and to potentially stimulate yet very young students, I think is to me very important. But you need those demonstrations, not just in wealthy schools or in wealthy touristy parts of town, or for students that have gotten to college. And that's why I felt that this project in Baltimore City that worked in an area that it can be, you can create, and there should be created models for living where people can live affordably, efficiently, but also have kind of the dignity of a good, clean, safe place that is affordable in terms of its efficiencies of resource use. But that baseline is something from which I think, who knows, the young folks that when these things are implemented all around you, as they are at the Sidwell School, what that might stimulate in terms of a student's imagination and mind to be activated. And that's something that happened with me at a young age, and I credit that getting back to this point, where I am right now, actually, with an aquatic biology teacher in my sixth grade, that pointed some of these things out to me, and I had access to that. And so I think that's where, for me, justice, there's a lot of different justices, but that's one of the ones that I have decided to try to focus part of my life on to try to make a difference.
Thank you, for you. The Baltimore, well, the Chesapeake Bay, or 135,000 acres of watershed that keeps pumping the nutrients and sediments into the bay is also part of the larger question of justice. I mean, how do we regulate that? I mean, that, because that seems to be going on happily, and there is a question of what kind of, well, national or, well, let's say regional context pose certain questions. I mean, you can clean up a lot, but if the pollution still continues, I mean, is that part of a larger justice question, and how would you handle that? And in your presentation, I hope we can hear some of the initiatives you've promoted in Botswana about national resource accounting and the ways in which water and justice are related to this. If you could just do a quick presentation, that'd be great, because we don't want to waste the opportunity to listen to you.
Is somebody going to turn the slides?
There is.
Okay. Yes, I think I want to sort of summarize what we've done in Botswana, because there's not just about water. Firstly, I want to say that we have to acknowledge Glenn Marie Lang, even though she's not here, she's with the World Bank. She's done a lot of work in Botswana, Namibia, and South Africa on water accounting. And we've also managed to convince at a presidential level that we call, our own president called for what we call the Gaborone Declaration, where African countries are signing up to say that natural capital is very important for Africa, because you find that our communities are living directly with the environment, and their livelihoods are the ones that are going to be affected even more if we don't gear up on this issue. Next slide. This is just general. We all know that income or GDP alone can give misleading information about economic progress, and as it is, does not include changes in natural capital. I think all of us know that. Can we go to the next slide? This is what we're really looking into when we're doing water accounting. We're looking more into issues of policy making. How can the work that we do manage to penetrate through policy? What are the issues with water productivity by sector? How do they contribute to GDP? And then we also use it for forecasting and provide it to the Ministry of Finance and Development Planning, because that is where the projects are going to be guided from. Can we have the next slide? This is basically the history of how we've come, because Botswana, we were very lucky. We had a Professor Parents of York University long time ago, before I even started working with the department in the 1990s, and we managed to do the work that you see up there. Actually, Botswana right now, if you look into the program of World Bank, it's called Wealth Accounting and Valuation of Ecosystem Services, WAVES. Botswana is one of the countries that has been picked up as a pilot because of the work that we did on water accounting. And this is important for justice because, as I said earlier, this resource accounting also assists in pricing, if you remember what we were talking about in terms of pricing, because somebody has to pay. You can't have water for free. And this water accounting exercise can assist in issues of losses in water, and it can assist in recharge and of aquifers and all that. And can we have the next thing? This is the WAVES that I was talking about. Those are the countries that are signatories to WAVES, and now they are even trying to get more countries to be part of WAVES. And this year, we have managed to. The idea is that eventually you'll have departments doing their own accounts. If it's water account, the Department of Water Affairs will be actually doing that. If it's mining, the Department of Mines will do the minerals accounts. If it's livestock, that will happen. Can we go to the next slide? So this is, as I said earlier, the ministries or the departments that are engaged. But I want to say that we have gone beyond, because in the interest of time, I want to talk about how we have gone into training economic planners, because I know most of you here are academics, but when it comes to being practical about water accounting and dealing with these issues, it's important that you talk to the Minister of Finance and Development Planning, because then they will be able to understand the link between natural capital and development, and they will be able to go into the sectors, whether it's agriculture, mining, as we're talking about water now, then we will be able to implement what we've been talking about here as ecological economists. And we have managed to do that in Botswana, even though it's a challenge, because we know this is a multidisciplinary exercise, and in government you can't get one ministry or one department with people of different expertise. So it's important to target different sectors. I think I'll stop there.
Thank you, Mokgadi. This has actually been very illustrative in showing us, like in the presentation that we saw today morning about food justice, about how intra-governmental coordination is important. But here again, is the voice of us as human agents, intra-governmental or as departments responsible or private sector responsible for cleaning up, are taking a major, or let's say, having an exclusive say about water justice or environmental justice. I just wanted Peter to reflect for a moment on well, equality between rivers or between different water bodies. Are all rivers the same, or are some more equal than the others?
For me, that's kind of an easy question. I've worked in the District of Columbia in Baltimore for a very long time, and I've traveled a bit, and I've just came back from Rio and Guanabara Bay, and met with individuals that were tasked with cleaning up Guanabara Bay before the Olympics. And how rivers and water bodies are perceived and treated can be very different, even in the District of Columbia here. And I think anybody that knows the district and has been here understands that there are two rivers. There's the Potomac River, which was a mess, but was cleaned up many decades ago. And then there's the Anacostia River, which is called the Other River in Washington, D.C., and D.C.'s Forgotten River. And it flows through the two poorest sections of Washington, D.C., Ward 7 and Ward 8. And it's gotten a lot of attention in the last couple of decades, but it's still a big effort. And I technically advise the Anacostia Watershed Society. And it's a struggle, but they're getting more attention. But it comes, I think one of the themes earlier that was spoken by several of our great guests was that it's not necessarily going to come from government. It often comes from a groundswell of individuals that are demanding it. And this watershed group formed 25 years ago to do that, to demand a better river. And for it to not be forgotten, and they pushed it to the forefront, and it's very much a part of being the politics of being at the table with the regulatory agencies, the funding entities, all of the political entities, and that is, I think, one of the important things that I think some folks can learn. We heard about, you know, how forests had groups of women in India that basically are standing up for the forests and demanding it, and that, I think, is where a lot of the power can be and should be. And for water bodies like Guanabara Bay and some of the tributaries that run into it, that's I think, where the groundwork needs to happen, is to get the people, and it has to come from the people in order to demand that cleaner water. And so, yes, there are many tiers of attention, and all rivers are the same. But in the way they're treated, they're often treated very differently, and that does need to change. But it needs to come from the individuals living in those watersheds that are impacted by them.
Thank you. That was an amazing presentation by both the speakers. I just wanted to give a little time. I don't know if we have time, but do we? Maybe another 5 minutes. A few questions, please. Here we go. One, two.
Thank you. Stanislav Shmelev, Environment Europe. It's been terrific to listen to these thoughts, and especially the presentation about Botswana and how water ecosystems are managed there. I have two major concerns, though. I was involved with IUCN and also the UK National Ecosystem Assessment follow-up phase, and there were two elements in the presentation. One of them referred to the fact that we need to show the impact of these, you know, water ecosystems on GDP. Well, this a very similar problem was faced by us in trying to discuss this with our funders a couple of years ago. We tried to make it explicit that if you don't have water or oxygen, there's nobody to discuss your GDP figures with, essentially. And that's something that escapes people's imagination very often. In fact, it's a very similar problem that was observed with energy and that was addressed by Bob Ayers in the previous decades. Economists neglected energy because it was a small fraction in GDP. And I'm really hoping that a similar mistake is not going to be made here, and it has been. And second, there was a second issue that I wanted to flag up, but I'll shut up now.
Volker Maufer, University of Vienna, Austria. Come back to the question which you raised, are all rivers the same? I would say it depends. It depends on the social ecological system also around them. So you could have islands which have one river and which would perfectly fit to manage the river, because the water basin is just within one nation, yeah? But even the system, the political system, the district system, distributes the powers for the water in a quite different way, and therefore there's a mismatch, which Oran Young describes in his books quite well, a mismatch between the ecosystem which is managed and the social system which puts down the rules, yeah? But there are countries which manage to rule one river which is going through 10 or 12 countries, and they just come together and say, okay, we define one authority for that river, and so that basin is even covering 12 countries, but you still, the river is still well managed. So it depends also on the social ecological system. It's just the input. Thank you.
Is this working? No? Yes? Okay, I'm Jonathan Harris, U.S. Ecological Economics Group. And listening to Peter May and looking at the Sidwell Friends School and the Chesapeake Bay examples, that's very inspiring. And it raised a thought in my mind that a couple of years ago, I was at the Mesoamerican Ecological Economics Conference, which was held in San Jose, Costa Rica, on the campus of the university there. It's a beautiful campus. They have a stream running through it. The stream is basically an open sewer. And that's because the sewage system in the city around is very poor, and you know, there are thousands of dwellings, buildings pouring sewage down, and it, you know, flows through the campus. I was wondering, you know, what are the possibilities of expanding the kind of system that you were talking about to severely polluted areas in Latin America, in India, in China, Africa? It looks to me like it should not be hugely expensive, and it should not be a luxury for the rich. This should be something that should be a part of sustainable development. It may be outside of the province that you've worked in immediately, you know, this area, but that seems to me to be an enormously important question for sustainable development.
Yes. I'm not too sure if I got you right on the impact, or on, I need to be clear, yes.
Well, in the previous decades, scientists looked at the energy sector in the economy and were saying, well, it's a very small percentage in GDP terms, therefore it's unimportant. Some of us have been arguing that it's actually, the opposite is true, and without it, you wouldn't be able to run your economy. The same applies to water in the equal amount. And actually, another issue that I wanted to flag was about the right to water. You said this has to be paid for, somebody has to pay for. Well, I could argue that this is part of the fundamental human rights, and it should be available to everybody without any pay.
Yes.
How would you deal with that?
Yes.
So, and isn't that the application of the so-called neoliberal thinking, which
yes,
we are suffering from,
yes,
in many places around,
yes,
the world?
Yes, I think I want to start with the one that you just, the second one, that water is a human right. I believe that. And I, if you were here when I started the presentation, I was saying that even in the Bushmen set up in a settlement, they're paying for it, because they're working to go and get the water. And they are living up to a norm that the chief will be against them if they don't live up to that norm. So that's, for me, is a price that they're paying. And I don't think that we need to think that water should be provided for free, because if the poor can't afford it, we can do a cross-subsidy. Somebody has to pay. It doesn't have to be the poor paying for it. They can have the water subsidized. That is my thinking. I'm not sure if we are together. And then the other one was on the thinking that this may take too long, because, you know, natural resources were not captured in the production function. Natural resources were treated as free goods because when we started economics, it was in abundance. So there was no need to start thinking about it as something that we need to factor into the production function. And actually, that's what resource economics or ecological economics is trying to take us back to say, these natural resources have a price, so we must start to factor them in. I'm not sure if we think. And then there was also, I wanted to comment a bit on the issue of water that, or rivers that cut across countries. And we have a good example between Botswana and South Africa and Namibia, where the South Africans have dammed a river upstream. And the communities downstream have no water. And but they settled there because there was water. But now they're poor, because if you don't have water, then you can't plow, you can't keep cattle, you can't support. So they are living on government welfare. So it's important to understand that as different countries, we need to respect water as a part of the ecological system, so that other communities can also sustain their lives.
To the question of interstate water resources and management, I happen to work for several years early in my career with the Interstate Commission on the Potomac River Basin. And that was a congressionally created quasi-governmental entity that manages the water resources and natural resources of the river for several states and the District of Columbia. And I saw that as a really that was set up in 1940, I believe, and I saw that as an incredibly progressive way, and of course that's all within the United States. But I do think that at its basis, all rivers, now ecologically they may be very different and have different metabolisms and communities, but they all should have the right to be managed fairly and appropriately. I also don't really separate humans and societies from these ecosystems. They're all part of the same system. And I think that getting to the access to water and water as a right, I think that if we can expand this template across national boundaries and even interstate out west, I mean, there's a whole legal life that is incredibly bizarre in terms of water management and water rights. But I think that there are, you know, getting to humans and societies that live within those ecosystems and those watersheds, that there is, they should have you know, basic access, and that is an incredibly difficult situation that needs to be ironed out. But I see the interstate water resource model as being a good one that ideally would be proliferated, where everybody works together to figure these things out. To getting to your question about in other countries, especially you know, with sewage, and I we have sewage treatment problems here. We're addressing them with, you know, some very large expenditures. Anacostia River has a couple billion-dollar tunnels that are going under the river to take combined sewage when it rains and put them in these tunnels until the wastewater treatment plant can accept them. That's incredible, that kind of expenditure. But I think in many other places, most places in the world, that's not an option. I had the pleasure of meeting one of my ecological engineering heroes, John Todd, who in the 60s and 70s, and even today, has been coming up with interesting low-energy ecologically engineered solutions to wastewater treatment. And he was recently in a shantytown in South Africa and gave me some background on the work he was doing there to treat essentially the sewage runoff problem through these shanty towns, but doing it in a very low-cost way that had an ecological benefit that incredibly reduced or eliminated the contact problem of children playing around. And it was a solution that is incredibly simple, a university in South Africa is studying it right now. And we were talking about possibly expanding that and using time on your side to implement these things. So there are solutions. They don't need to be big, expensive solutions that need very large grants to do. And I've seen them. I've seen them work. And I'm interested in solutions. I have an affinity for Brazil, not just because my doppelganger Peter May works there, but we finally met. But the issue of all of the favelas on these steep hillsides and water and sewage. Personally, I don't think we need to be transporting sewage with potable water or even rainwater. I think it's way too valuable for that, and we need to get to an alternative model, but that's another story.
Thank you. To sum up these two brilliant and also extremely diverse presentations from two totally different contexts, we can't think of water and justice without thinking about social justice and equality. And two, there is an essential harmony amongst people and between humans and nature that should be part of water and justice. I'm sum up here. Thank you very much indeed.